Street, which is one block off from the ocean. Beaconsfield Parade is the name of the road that goes along the ocean there. And Srila Prabhupada in the morning would walk out there and go along. Now, because Prabhupada's getting into the car, it indicate that he would be going down to the botanical gardens. Because if he was going on to the beachfront, he would just, you know, walk. This is Prabhupada arriving in the botanical gardens there in Melbourne, which was a very beautiful place. You know that the British had the tradition of building these elaborate botanical gardens in wherever they would have the colonies, whether it was in Africa or in India, though Australia was like that too. They would have these elaborate botanical gardens that they would construct, and they would bring all these different exotic trees into one place. And Srila Prabhupada would go early in the morning, and he would come and say, they spent so much money building this, and now, look, at in the morning, no one has come to take advantage of it. We're the only ones. Prabhupada would be walking in the botanical gardens at 7 in the morning, and everybody else would be whizzing by in their cars going to work. And we would be taking advantage of their botanical gardens. Srila Prabhupada would preach the philosophy of Krishna consciousness using nature. He would tell us many times that you can learn from nature. And when he would be going on these morning walks, he would point out things. And he would amaze us. Sometimes he would say, oh, this is a certain type of a tree. And he would quote the name of the tree in Latin, like he was some kind of a botanist. And lo and behold, we'd go and look at the tree, and the name would be there, and it would be that tree. And he would point out the medicinal value in the trees. And Prabhupada was very educated, not just in spiritual things, but he had so much material knowledge that he would amaze the devotees.
You could see the city from the distance, and there were buildings. And I can't remember exactly his question, but it was something along the lines of, why do they build these big buildings? And being somebody who was always a little bit in awe of architecture, I remember saying something like, well, they like to be remembered, you know. I'm doing some big construction. I guess that's a sort of the fault of an artist anyway, isn't it? Do a painting or leave something behind. And Prabhupada said, that's exactly the same as the washerman's donkey. He likes to be known for being able to carry some big load. It's just no different. Yeah, the washerman's ass. I remember thinking then, I was working at the time as a designer and an artist, and I had a job in a TV studio here in Melbourne. Prabhupada's sort of dismissing so-called lofty aesthetics of contemporary architecture. The mode of passion, I guess it is, isn't it? You know, you like to work in the mode of passion and leave something behind that you'll be known for. But yeah, Prabhupada's perspective sort of cut through it.
All of us would just pile into cars and then follow Prabhupada for the morning walk. We'd all follow behind. You'd have the leaders in front. You'd have Madhavisa, who was the GBC. Deepak, he was the temple president of Melbourne at the time. And you had a few others there. And then the rest of us would be walking behind. And it had been raining a little bit, so the grass was moist. And Prabhupada would be walking along the pathway, like a cemented pathway, and then just go straight off the pathway and walk across the grass. And so I just read just the day before that Lord Chaitanya, wherever he stepped, people would take the dust of his feet. So I thought I should get some dust from Prabhupada's feet. And so I was walking behind Prabhupada. Madhavisa was on his right and Deepak was on his left. And then I was looking for the footprints. I could see the footprints of Madhavisa and Deepak really clearly. As you walk in the grass, it leaves an imprint quite deep, about half an inch deep. And I was looking, Prabhupada wasn't making an impression in the grass. So I decided that I would get right down to actually see Prabhupada's foot come off and see the grass underneath. And I was looking as Prabhupada's foot came off. The grass even wasn't bent or anything. It wasn't that Prabhupada was like, you know, an inch or two off the ground. It wasn't like that. It appeared that Prabhupada's feet were actually touching the ground, but they weren't. I became a little confused at that time. I didn't really understand what I was seeing. And then later I read in Bogota, where Yudhishthira Maharaj, he never touched the ground. So I understood from that that Prabhupada was a Nitya Siddha, that he was never a conditioned soul and he came directly from the spiritual world. I mean, I didn't need to see that to come to that conclusion, because by serving Prabhupada, I was able to experience within that my understanding of Krishna consciousness and my detachment from the world, as it was developing, I understood that this is a pure Vaishnava. Because, you know, serving a materialist or ordinary person, these things don't happen in the heart. But that was really wonderful to see that.
My son Janaka, who was very young at the time, probably 4 years old, and one morning walk, Srila Prabhupada took Janaka's hand in his, squeezed it very hard and kept it in his pocket all through the morning walk. It was probably Janaka, my son, that spent more personal time with Srila Prabhupada than I did. In the Melbourne temple, he used to go up to Srila Prabhupada's rooms. I would dress him in the morning and he'd disappear for the day. Prabhupada's assistants travelling with him and the other devotees would be standing guard at Prabhupada's door to his room. So Janaka knew his way in and out of Prabhupada's room, so he'd sneak in through the side window and spend the day with Srila Prabhupada. He'd play boats in the bathroom when Srila Prabhupada slept. Sometimes he would sleep under the bed there with Prabhupada, take prasadam with him.
When we were on morning walks, Prabhupada would, of course, be chanting japa, and then we would follow in unison. And then Prabhupada would stop and he would say something or point out some philosophical point. He'd walk on again and everyone would start chanting japa. And this little Mataji, Ramaniya, her name was, her chanting was over and above everyone else's chanting, very loud. And sometimes he couldn't hear what Prabhupada was saying, but he had to really snuggle in around Prabhupada as close as you could to actually hear what he was saying. And so you might hear, you know, someone chanting japa in the background, not knowing what to do when they couldn't hear what Prabhupada was saying. So then Ramani was chanting this japa very loud, and everyone else was thinking, oh, she's chanting so loud. You could kind of feel the vibe of the devotees. You know, tone it down, please. And then Prabhupada actually commented, she's chanting very nicely. You know, this is good chanting. So that put us in our place.
Prabhupada had gone out on his walk and something needed doing in Prabhupada's room. I don't recall exactly what it was. I think it was to tidy up. There must have been a lot of devotees in there before he went for the walk. Anyway, I was feeling Prabhupada's potency in the room. I was feeling very low, dirty and unclean. And what are you? Who are you to put yourself before this exalted person? I could recognise that. You know, he was just so glorious. And I think you should go away out of the sight from this man. You don't belong here. I was actually thinking that in my mind, yeah. And as I thought that, the front gate there opened and Prabhupada looked straight up at me and beamed a big smile and called me down to greet the deities. So I went down and went in the temple. So that sort of dissipated any doubts. I thought, well, if Prabhupada's accepting, then I felt freed from that. And I served then for 16 years non-stop, 18 hours a day.
I stayed behind to do the room and get the room all ready for Srila Prabhupada, and I would always be downstairs and open the door when Prabhupada came in, and there was a huge kirtan. Prabhupada came in and I had some flowers in my hand, and Prabhupada walked up the stairs. And in Melbourne there was an area where you got halfway up the stairs, there was a landing, and then you went further up. And Prabhupada walked up the stairs, and when Prabhupada turned around and the kirtan was louder and louder, and Prabhupada looked down at me and he saw I had the flowers in my hand, he walked back down the stairs and took the flowers out of my hand and walked back up the stairs. That was pretty far out.
Why is that in varieties?
They say originally there was just a cell, and by adaptation, in some circumstances, one kind would live and another would die. So all these varieties adapted to different conditions.
Who adapted?
Well, they just
who managed?
Accidentally.
That is nonsense. Nothing happens accidentally. that is not. There must be some arrangement. What is happening here is accidental.
What is happening?
Why you are taking care of the trees? So many things. Nothing is done. Accident. You do not see the cause. Let accidentally money come and sit down. Why do they not do that? If accident is there, let accident come and I become rich man. Why do they try? Why they go to the college? Let accidentally become a PhD. This is all a scandal. There are five causes. Activity, the place, the proportion of energy, and ultimately sanctioned by God. Then things happen. Otherwise, there is no question of accident.
Srila Prabhupada really made a point about the neck beads should always be tight. They were, you know, bought off the shelf somewhere in Vrindavan, whatever, so they wouldn't be tailor-made for the devotees' necks, so they'd usually be just loose. But even though they were put on loosely, Srila Prabhupada insisted on a number of occasions that no, they must be tight. I think it's got something to do with remembering the beads are there and, you know, that we're servants of the spiritual master like that.
I remember I was very nervous, of course, going before Prabhupada to receive an initiation. Is that me there? I think so. Put on about 40 kilos since. I was worried that I would forget before rules and regulations, so I said no illicit sex, no gambling, no intoxication, no meat eating, like that, to try and make sure I didn't forget. And then Prabhupada said so many negatives, because I was stressing the word no, as though it was abhorrent to give these things up. And Prabhupada said, isn't there any positive? And then I said, I'm chanting Hare Krishna 16 rounds.
There were a number of occasions when I was involved or sat in or was part of initiations. Srila Prabhupada always insisted that the doors and windows remain closed. Devotees would open the windows like as if the smoke coming from the fire was a botheration. I don't know exactly why, but he would insist that we just keep the doors and windows closed. It didn't matter. The smoke was not harmful.
There was a chaise lounge that he would sit on when the guests came. He would sit there and preach to the guests. This was a very big room. All the devotees could actually fit. It was almost as big as the temple room. One particular preaching engagement was with a social worker from the Department of Social Welfare. We actually rang up the departments and tried to get the ministers to come and meet with him, but the minister couldn't come, but he sent one of his top men. And this man came along, and actually he was very, very nervous. And I don't think he actually wanted to be there. Anyhow, he met with Prabhupada, and he was respectful. And then Prabhupada started to tell him about our principles, and how one of our principles was no illicit sex. And when Prabhupada mentioned this man became very, very agitated. And Prabhupada kept talking about this, and this man became so agitated that in the end he wanted to cut the conversation off. Although Prabhupada was giving him the answers and the solutions to so many of their social welfare problems, this man was not willing to listen. Prabhupada's preaching was very powerful, but they were not willing to hear. And also on the same visit, he met with one man whose name was Brian Dixon. And Brian Dixon was a very, very famous man in the state of Victoria. He was a very famous footballer. And later on after that, he became a politician, government minister. He came with his secretary, and she was not dressed very appropriately. She had a short dress. She had the makeup on and everything, and she was very provocatively dressed. So Brian Dixon came in and met Srila Prabhupada, and he made the comment straight away that he saw the Hare Krishna devotees on the streets singing and dancing and chanting, and whenever he saw them, he saw that they were always happy. So he asked Srila Prabhupada, why are you successful? And he knew that we did not participate in taking drugs. And he was impressed by this, and Prabhupada explained that we follow four principles, and one of them is no intoxication, and that by chanting Hare Krishna you become happy. And Brian Dixon, he was listening. So then Prabhupada mentioned that we do not engage in illicit sex. And Brian Dixon became embarrassed. He actually blushed like anything. Almost immediately, he looked at his watch and said, oh, sorry, we've got another appointment. And he had to leave. So Prabhupada was preaching very, very strongly. And he was giving these particular men the answers to their problems that they were dealing with. But again, they were not willing to listen or to implement this particular program. Then again, we had one newspaper reporter come from the Age newspaper, which is the main Melbourne newspaper. And Srila Prabhupada preached to this man for about 45 minutes. Simply preached to him about, you are not this body. Straight preaching. Although the man was asking general sort of questions, Prabhupada just stuck with this one point of how you are not this body and you are the servant of Krishna. And he just preached to the guy full on. And the guy just sat there and listened. So then the next day, he wrote a very, very nice article. It was about half a page on the second page of the Melbourne Age, quite an extensive article and very well written, because most newspaper reporters, they actually misinterpret what the original message was. And we showed Srila Prabhupada the newspaper article the next day, and he was so pleased that he asked us to get 12 copies of that particular article, and he got his secretary to send them to some of the Big Life members in India.
He would hold darshans there some evenings in his room, and he'd sit and talk, and Prabhupada would display his usual erudite knowledge. But he had this compassion that he would hear everyone and consider, even if you spoke, you could only feel foolish in front of Prabhupada, but he seemed to tolerate. And he had a lot of compassion. But at the same time, with the guests that would come, he would show a lot of interest, but he would not tolerate the subject being moved. So he would be very quick to bring the subject back within the Krishna conscious domain, even if he would insinuate that they were in illusion. He did it in such a way that nobody was ever offended. Prabhupada had this knack of speaking to people. So in Melbourne, I remember he spoke to one of the parents of a devotee, and he made them feel extremely comfortable. But at the same time, Prabhupada was very strong in stressing that Krishna consciousness was for everyone and not just a sectarian movement, but it was for everyone and it was a practical movement. Prabhupada had this skill of disarming people's defense just through his purity and his straight speaking and his simple language. And it was understood by everyone. There was nothing duplicit in his language. It was straightforward.
My uncle, Father Wallace, he was a Jesuit, but he was in charge of the whole of Victoria, so he's like the head Jesuit. And I said to my mother, I'd like to get my uncle to meet Prabhupada, so somehow she got that arranged. My mum was pretty good at arranging those things. And so my uncle came, and we're all sitting around in Prabhupada's beautiful room on the beautiful blue carpet, and he was sitting back in the chairs, and he was quite elegant sort of a guy, and a very good speaker. As the Jesuits are pretty well trained in philosophy, Prabhupada spoke philosophy with him quite a bit, and he seemed to be able to follow the thread of it and answer it, which most people, when they met Prabhupada, they kind of lost it. Prabhupada was just probing into what they understood, and they couldn't understand what they believed themselves, but he seemed to have some belief himself. Anyway, it went on for about, I guess, 3/4 of an hour, having a pretty lively conversation, but jokey too, a lot of laughter and so on. And then finally the session was over and he got up and shook hands and left, and we're all sitting around Prabhupada, and Prabhupada sitting there just kind of rocking a bit. And I said, oh, Srila Prabhupada, what did you think of my uncle? And Prabhupada looked at us all and he smiled and he looked at me and he said, a very pleasant drunkard. And that was like, we just all cracked up laughing, because immediately he walked in, Prabhupada must have picked up he'd had something. And I wouldn't be surprised if he was a regular drinker. He had that kind of look. his face, you know, a bit over reddish. And yes, it was pretty well strong through the whole order at that time, I'd say, the whole Catholic Church. That was the one thing the priest could do, have a good drink. But the way Prabhupada could crack a joke was really amazing.
The minister is elected according to the Queen of Society.
Because they have made a department just like you do. What is the department?
Social welfare.
Social welfare. So if they find social welfare, why not help? Why they bring politics? If actually there is social welfare here, why they should not support it?
Yeah, well, you're right. But in our society, minister is elected to carry out certain policies. Not what he wants, but what the people sort of voted for. And say a text to support.
And if your policy is social reformation.
Social reform is not our policy.
Then social welfare.
So just to look after those who are in trouble. That's our policy.
Well, everyone is in trouble.
What?
At the present moment, even the ministers are in trouble.
Yes, but that is not what our function is. Everybody's in trouble.
Physician, he dies. You see? They are also drunkards, they are also woman hunters, and meat eaters, and gambling, that's all. They require to be rectified.
But they can't help that. That society, you have to go and change society. The society tells us to act.
But unless you change the society, how can you make social welfare?
Well,
if
different
you keep them as it is, then where is the question of welfare?
Give it a different interpretation to the word.
I don't...
Does understand me?
Basically.
Yes.
Basically, one must be first-class ideal man.
Yeah.
That is one.
That's why it's so very difficult. You have to work on your own and only have to see that you have freedom to work. But if you convince enough people to go your
own. Our own program, it is not Vox Populi. You find out fault with us.
What?
You find out what is our fault.
I don't see any fault.
Then you can disable. But when you see everything is nice, how you will not accept it? Unless you are biased.
Of course I'm biased. I've been brought up differently.
Yeah. That's like our...
Because you're biased against my life.
No, we are not biased. We
you say everyone
like we are not biased. We are allowed. We say that if you want to be first class man, then you must not commit sinful activities. That is our problem.
But I as a public servant, I'm not here to change society. Society
we are also public.
What
we
to do?
We belong to the public. You must become our servant also.
Yeah. What?
We are public, members of the public.
Yeah.
So you should become our servant also. If you are public servant.
A public servant is in our philosophy, is a man who serves a minister elected by the people. And this way he serves the public.
Yeah.
And what the public decides, it votes accordingly.
We are informing the public. Just like we are proposing here. I'm not proposing. Krishna says that one must be peaceful. But how to become peaceful? If his mind is always disturbed, how he can become peaceful?
You're quite right.
So that is the secret of success. You have to make people peaceful, but you do not know how to make him peaceful.
Yeah.
So therefore you have to adopt this.
You have a competitive society.
Yeah. We say that you chant Hare Krishna, eat here sumptuously, live here comfortably, and you become peaceful.
Mm.
It is guaranteed. If anyone, even a madman agrees to this principle, that let him chant Hare Krishna mantra, take whatever nice food stuff we prepare, take, and live peacefully. He will be peaceful.
What's your answer that still such a small percentage of the population, tiny percentage of the population,
no,
accept a philosophy that
so tiny percentage, just like there are so many stars in the sky,
yeah.
And there is one moon. In percentage, the moon is nothing. If you take percentage of the star, the moon is nothing. But moon is important than all the nonsense stars. But if you take percentage, there is no percentage moon. But because he is moon, he is important than all these rascal stars. This is the example. What is the use of taking percentage of the stars in the presence of moon? Let there be one moon, that is sufficient. There is no question of percentage. One idea remains. Just like in Christian world, one idea of Jesus Christ.
How do you feel about Mao Zedong?
Huh? What is that?
This is how you feel about Mao Zedong. In China, his ideal man. He's a communist.
His ideal is all right.
In China, he is.
His idea, communist idea, that everyone should be happy. That is good idea. But they do not know how to make it. Just like they are taking care of the human being in the state, but they are sending poor animals to the slaughterhouse. So, for the satisfaction of the tongue of the human being, the animals should be cutthroat. That is the defect.
One minister regards himself as a servant of the people, who can be kicked out.
That is the defect. The people are rascals and they have elected another rascal. That is the defect.
Well, but that's how it is.
So what can we get? That is hopeless.
Oh, you can work on the class.
We are going, without depending on this rascal. Yes. We are going on. If we instruct a man, please do not have illicit sex. Have you got any objection?
What?
If I advise somebody that do not have illicit sex, have you got any objection?
Yeah, I have.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Illicit?
I like sex. My wife likes sex.
Huh?
We just enjoy it. I couldn't live without it. Our marriage is happier because they have sex.
That's it. No, we don't prohibit sex. We probably
don't have two children.
Illicit sex.
Well, it's a, you use a pill, or you use contraceptives, or you use all kinds of things. Because it makes all.
Do you use contraceptives?
Because I don't want any more children.
Then why don't you stop sex?
Because I like sex.
Yes.
Because I enjoy it.
That means go to physician. I want to do everything I like, still I want treatment. This is the position. You want...
I didn't come for treatment.
You have come for treatment here.
I was involved in
it. Because you have failed to control the society, your activity, therefore you have come here, treatment. But when I prescribe medicine, you don't accept.
I haven't come for treatment.
No, yes. Otherwise, why
you only involved?
Just to help you in your social activities, social welfare activities, to take some suggestion from her. But when you give the suggestion, you reject it. That is your position.
Srila Prabhupada would always give wonderful lectures, but sometimes devotees would be falling asleep, maybe due to having too much prasadam. And I must admit, in those days, I used to fall asleep a lot. But I do remember one incident. It really floored people. We had a program at the Palais Theatre in St Kilda, which was a pretty hip part of town. And it wasn't a very big theatre, and it was kind of cozy and intimate. It was eclectic, put it that way, you know. There was a lot of philosopher hippie types there, and Srila Prabhupada was sitting on this Vyasasan. He gave this lecture, and the acoustics, unfortunately, weren't that good. It was reverberating around the room, and it was hard to catch what Srila Prabhupada was saying, but there were a lot of people there. And anyway, at one particular point, somebody asked a question. Well, there are so many yogis and swamis that have come and this and that. What can you do? Either what can you do, inferring what that others can't do, or what can you do? And Srila Prabhupada said, I can save you from death. And then there was complete silence, and everyone knew that Srila Prabhupada meant it. It was the most sobering thing I've ever heard someone say. So from then on, the rest of the program was sober. People were respectful. Prabhupada had a great, great affection for Australia and the preaching in Australia, because we could see that when hearing Prabhupada giving lectures at different parts of the world, he would refer back to Australia, how the preaching was going on in Australia, and they have gone to jail in Australia, they have a Rath Yatra, and they're distributing more books in Australia than everywhere else in the world. And it was a great joy for Srila Prabhupada to have his devotees in Australia. He sent some of his dear devotees there in the beginning. Bali Mardan and Upendra Das went there in the beginning, and it was an English-speaking country that had never been exposed to Krishna consciousness or anything like Krishna consciousness before. It was a completely fresh start. Whereas in England, some of his godbrothers had gone there before, and there was some, you know, affiliation with India. But Australia was like a remote, far remote place. And people had taken to Krishna consciousness very elaborately and very, diligently. And it was through the book distribution that could be gauged. That here in Australia, a relatively small country, maybe 15 or 17 million people in the whole country, they were one of the top book distributors in the whole world at that time. At one point, Australia was the number one book distributing country in the world in the early 70s. And we used to, you know, make sure that Srila Prabhupada heard about that. We would send the report, and Srila Prabhupada was always beaming. I remember when he came out with the Chaitanya Chaitamrita, and we were there in India, and Prabhupada said, and we will print 15,000 volumes of this book. And I was there and I said, Prabhupada, we'll take 10,000. And Prabhupada said, oh, Madhavis is taking 10,000 already. We must print 20,000. And Prabhupada saw that this was a young and vibrant and healthy country. Sometimes Australia is referred to as the lucky country. And Srila Prabhupada would go there, and he would love the ghee that was there, the cow's ghee. So he worked out a program that the Australian devotees could pay for their books in ghee, because there was money being sent from Los Angeles to India to finance all the different building projects there. So instead of having the devotees from Australia send money from Australia to Los Angeles, then in Los Angeles send money to India, Prabhupada said, no, forget about all that sending back and forth. Instead of paying for your books in dollars to Los Angeles, pay for your books in ghee sent to India. Because this high-quality ghee sent from Australia to India was more valuable than the dollars sent to Australia. And this way, he would send the ghee, and he said the devotees would be able to distribute this ghee to life members in India and feed the devotees with high-quality ghee, so they would stay healthy while they were doing their preaching work in India. For so many years, thousands of pounds of ghee. This Alauri ghee, a very famous ghee, came in this big 10-gallon tin or 5-gallon tin, paying for our books in ghee. That was quite unique.
I was the guard, so to speak, stopping the hordes getting up there and bothering him. And Prabhupada used to come out of his room very late at night or early in the morning and go into the other room where he would do his dictation. And I'd just be sitting there with my Bhagavad Gita. Sometimes I'd be fully conscious and sometimes I'd be partially not conscious. And Prabhupada stopped one time and just spoke to me. He asked me what my name was and he asked me a few simple questions, and I sort of replied back to him. I was a bit nervous being around Prabhupada, in the sense that I was in awe of Prabhupada and I didn't really feel comfortable being too familiar. I was a little bit awestruck by Prabhupada. So, we just had a few simple exchanges on the top of the steps in the dead of night. And Prabhupada went off into his room and did his translating. It inspired me, thinking that there's no one else awake except the two of us, and Prabhupada's in there actually translating the Bhagavatam.
Every night after the Bhagavatam class, there was a big feast that was served out in what was known as Parampara Hall. which was a large room on the ground floor of Prabhupada House. That was the prasadam room at the time. So Dwipayana and other cooks prepared very, very nice prasadam, and this was the highlight of the evening for many, especially those who had come to the temple for the first time. On the second night, I remember Dwipayana had prepared apple crumble, and apple crumble of those days was apples with cinnamon with a mixture of oats, flour and butter, and baked in the oven till the topping was crispy. Now, it was a bit controversial because we thought that oats were not fit to be eaten by devotees. Somebody said that Prabhupada said that oats are meant for horses. So some devotees thought that apple crumble was not bona fide. Anyway, Dwipayana made apple crumble, many, many, many trays of it. Some of the best apple crumble that he'd ever made. After the lecture, Prabhupada went up to his room and he felt a little hungry, and he asked Srinikirti to go down and see what prasadam there was available, what was being served for the devotees. So Srinikirti went down to the kitchen and brought back some apple crumble. Prabhupada ate a whole bowl of it, and then he sent Srinikirti downstairs for more. He said, "Please bring me more of those crispy apples." And after we heard the story, we realized that apple crumble was now bona fide and fit to be eaten by devotees. So then apple crumble became a dessert that was served at practically every feast.
So our process of knowledge, we should take from the supreme authority. Then we save time for research work. That is Krishna consciousness movement. We take perfect knowledge from Krishna. I may be imperfect, just like child is imperfect. I may be imperfect, you may be imperfect. But if you take the perfect knowledge from the Supreme Perfect, then your knowledge is perfect. That is the process. This is called avarohokantha, knowledge coming, deductive knowledge. So everything is there, and if you like to take advantage of this movement, make your life perfect, go back to home, back to Godhead, then fully utilize the center, our Melbourne center, come here, read our books, and argue, try to understand with your full knowledge, no blindly acceptance. There is reason, there is argument, there is philosophy, there is science, everything is there. And if you accept that simply by chanting I shall realize, that is also allowed. Both ways. If you accept this simple process, the chant Hare Krishna and realize God, that is also fact. And if you think what is this nonsense chanting Hare Krishna, then you read books. Both ways we are prepared. Come and take advantage of this moment. Thank you very much.
Jai!
Prabhupada, we have decided in the scriptures that Lord Rama rides on a swan, a hamsa. Is this, we take this to mean that it's a real swan, or is it something symbolic?
Not symbolic, it's fact. Why do you say symbolic?
It's rather unusual.
Unusual? What experience you have got? You have no experience. Have you got any experience of other planetary system? What is there? Then? Your experience is very teeny. So you should not calculate Brahma's life and other things by your teeny experience. Now, in the Bhagavad Gita it is said that the duration of life of Brahma, sahasra yuga parjantam arhajat brahmano vidu. Now Brahma's life, it is stated in the Shastra. We have already explained that we accept the authoritative statement of Shastra. Now Brahma's life is stated there. Arhat means his one day is equal to our four yugas. Four yugas means 4,300,000 years. And multiply it by 1,000. Sahasra, Juga Padyantam. Sahasra means 1,000. And Juga, Juga means the 4,300,000 years makes a Juga. And multiply it by 1,000. That period is Brahma's one day. Similarly, he has got one night. Similarly, he has got one month. Similarly, he has got one year. And such 100 years he will live. So how you can calculate? How it is within your experience? You'll think something mysterious? No. Your experience is nothing. Therefore, you have to take experience from the perfect person, Krishna. Then your knowledge is perfect. That I've already said. Don't try to understand with your teeny experience everything. Then you'll be failure.
Yes. In one efforts to serve Krishna virtually.
That I've already explained, that you are coming here, even though you are not initiated, that is also service. So, if you deposit 1 cent daily, one day it may become $100. So when you get the $100, you can get the business. So you come here daily, 1 cent, 1 cent, when it will be $100, you will become a devotee. So this is not wasted. It is, that is stated in the Srimad Bhagavatam, Krita Punna Punya. Krita Punna. Krita means done. And Sukadeva Goswami is describing when Krishna was playing with his coward boy's friends. So he was describing that these coward boys who are playing with Krishna, they have not come to this position in one day. Krita Punna Punya, after life, having performed pious activities, now they have come to this position, that they are allowed to play with the Supreme.
This person possesses
the
suffering of when they say that they're happy and they're not afraid to die.
Someone who is not afraid to die and says that he's not suffering, how does
he's a madman. Who is caring for madmen?
It's very easy to convince some people that they're not their bodies. It's not very easy to convince them that they're not their minds. Is there some way we could explain?
That will take time. How can we explain? In 1 minute everyone will understand everything. It requires education, time. If he's prepared to give the time, then he will understand. Not that within 5 minutes, 10 minutes he'll understand the whole thing. That's not possible. A diseased man, he requires treatment, medicine, and diet. In this way, he'll understand. A diseased man, if he doesn't care for medicine, diet, then he'll suffer. That's all. Yes?
If we begin here lifetime before we begin pious activities, well, does it mean that we have to be here lifetime after lifetime performing pious activities to develop our sinful reactions?
We have been here for many lifetimes performing sinful activities. So is it possible to counteract all those sinful activities in one lifetime, or does it require many
1 minute. That is Krishna consciousness. 1 minute. You are not reading Bhagavad Gita? What Krishna says? Sarva dharmān parityajya māme ekaṁ saraṇaṁ braja aṁta sarva pāpebhyo mokṣayāmi. You surrender to me, give up your all business. I'll give you relief from all sinful reactions immediately. ridiculous 1 minute. When I got Krishna, I was forgotten. Now I understand, I fully surrender to you. And I become immediately free from all things. Without any reservation, without any politics. If you fully surrender, Krishna is assuring. Aham tva sarva papi mokkha iṣṣāmi mā sūcha. He reassures. Don't worry whether I will be able to give you relief from all fears. Mā sūcha. Finish. Guaranteed. You do this. So, how much time it requires to surrender to Krishna? Immediately you can do that. Mami vashtasi, asangsa, then you come to me without any doubt. Everything is there. Krishna has given everything fully. If you accept it, then life is very simple. There is no difficulty. Yes?
How long do you say it is before Krishna comes to this
Hare Krishna. So this course from yesterday. In Radha's boutique, we distribute 10 books for a total of 255 Lakshmi points. Yesterday in Govinda's, in a half day, we served 98 at least 98 customers and collected 1,224.87 Lakshmi points. And on books yesterday, Bhakti Dmitri distributed 36 medium, 1 big, and collected 50 Lakshmi points for a total of 19 book points. Yesterday we had a very nice Sankirtan seminar with Vishwambhar Prabhu. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 devotees went out on books, distributed 21 medium books, 12 Mahabig books, collected 77 Lakshmi.